government is saying, you have to increase your COVID beds by 30%, blah, 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 blah. So in terms of a business and MBA perspective or PhD, whatever your levels are, what's your take on all of this, Mr. Gonzalez?
We've had to sort of like limit access to the emergency rooms because we don't have enough ICU beds, which is the main bottleneck here. If you do a flashback to a year ago, that was the major constraint, and the emergency room ended up becoming an ICU ward.
Mm-hmm.
Now the government at that time said we're gonna designate more hospitals as COVID hospitals. So you have East Avenue, then you have PGH increasing its number of beds and others. Apparently, that was not enough because we all got caught short in March of this year when cases shot up to double what they were averaging last year.
Mm-hmm.
And so that really has been the major fear, that we don't have enough treatment capacity. Now, how to solve that issue? Last year, PhilHealth stepped in early on and said, we're going to reimburse everybody in the beginning for all your costs, okay? Which I think was a bit overblown. Then they said, we're going to limit the reimbursements, okay? But the problem with limiting the reimbursement is the severe and critical cases, moderate to severe and critical, where a lot of the expenses, because you're having have to do a lot more treatment, hemoperfusions and all this extra dosage of patient care, more nurses, as an example, the reimbursement factors haven't been enough. Mm-hmm. So hospitals are struggling with two things. One is facilities, and second is reimbursements. Okay. So in the case of the facility side, the way we see it is the government has said, all right, we'll open more ICU beds. Mm-hmm. Actually, they said we'll open more moderate beds, so you can try to move people out. But we still have a big constraint on ICU capacity. And the way to do that is to get more funding into facilities for what's called like negative pressure rooms.
Mm-hmm.
So you can circulate out the air from COVID. And those cost money. And to the extent that the government can, or the government banks can provide that kind of funding, then we can be more flexible in terms of capacity management. The second issue is reimbursements. You can have the DOH say move up to 30-35%, but if you're not getting paid, you are going to continue to be running a deficit. I guess the last part here is having to do with the manpower, and this is mainly nurses. And in the case mm-hmm. of nurses, you have higher nurse-to-patient ratios for the more severe COVID, And we have problems with our nurses because they're being pulled overseas without as much of the requisite tests and certifications that they had before, because other countries are suffering. And second, because of K2, we're into the second year of minimal graduates from nursing. And that has a major adverse impact in terms of the ability to staff. So everyone is going after the same pool. So the way to expand the pool is to allow maybe nurses who haven't taken the boards to participate more in the care of patients. Number two, to provide additional incentives for nurses to be hired. To staff the different hospitals, including the private sector, which was also done last year. Mm-hmm. So those two elements can expand capacity for nurses. And then also, as in the case of vaccination that's going on right now, to bring in other types of ancillary medical, like medical technologists or even midwives, to support that whole process of making sure that our whole country is inoculated against COVID.